Hi, if you're on a benzodiazepine, you might want to watch this. We're going to talk about benzodiazepine weaning and how to do it properly. So we're going to continue our discussion around benzodiazepine-induced neurological dysfunction. And so last episode, we talked about the experience of patients and we talked about the risk factors, which were related to cognitive impairment for experience. And the risk factors were related to the overall benzodiazepine load, elderly patients, and also concomitant polypharmacy. So I want to explain to you the current thinking about how benzodiazepine-induced neurological dysfunction occurs, and it's really related to the fact that benzodiazepines and Z-drugs, drugs like zopiclone and zolpidem, they basically are inhibitory. And so what they do is they increase the functional effect of the main inhibitory neurotransmitter in the brain, GABA, gamma-aminobutyric acid. When the brain is exposed to an inhibitory influence, in the longer term, the brain compensates to oppose that inhibitory effect. And the theory is that a lot of bind occurs as a result of that compensation for the prolonged inhibitory effect. And there's a couple of things that go on in the brain. Firstly, we have a homeostatic compensatory glutamic acid neuroexcitation. And glutamic acid is the main stimulatory neurotransmitter in the brain. So when we increase the function of the main inhibitory neurotransmitter in the brain, we increase the main stimulatory neurotransmitter in the brain. So you've got an elevated excitotoxic stimulus, right? Too much glutamate in the brain can wreak havoc to your mental state, right? Then we've got the concept of benzodiazepine resistance. So changes in the receptor mean that the receptor cannot actually recognize and respond to benzodiazepines. And in previous episodes of Cracking Addiction, I've discussed receptor pharmacology, and fundamentally, the benzodiazepine receptor changes from sensitive to non-sensitive states associated with the use of alpha subunits. Alpha 4 and alpha 6 subunits are not sensitive to benzodiazepines, and they're what we call neurosteroid sensitive. So they're sensitive to a different group of neurotransmitters. And then the third mechanism is actually a reduction in the number of receptors for GABA. So remember, the GABA receptor is the target for benzodiazepines, and if you've got fewer GABA receptors, you've got fewer, or you've got a reduced opportunity for benzodiazepines to actually exert their effect. So there, broadly speaking, there are three mechanisms. And it is thought that all of these work together to effectively cause what I term a central sensitization of the brain. Think about fibromyalgia as a primary sensitization syndrome associated with pain. I think we can now think about bind as a central sensitization manifesting in a wide range of symptoms, including anxiety symptoms. And if we look at the symptoms that emerge, so we see new benzodiazepine-related symptoms. So these are symptoms that were not present when the patient originally started benzodiazepines. And these symptoms can emerge during prolonged use and also during withdrawal and also after. That's the key thing, after cessation. The original symptoms can also increase in intensity. So if you're starting your journey into benzodiazepine use because of anxiety, here's the kicker, right? Your anxiety, because of this central sensitization, your anxiety can actually get worse, right? So you get to a point where effectively you're using petrol to put out the fire. And again, this is the same thing occurs with opioid toxicity. One of the side effects of opioids is something that we call opioid-induced hyperalgesia, where actually the opioid is causing the pain for which the patient is taking more opioids. So I think this is a similar situation. I think we can see bind in a similar light, where people are having to take more and more benzodiazepines to treat an anxiety that is getting worse because of benzodiazepine use. Again, using petrol to put out the fire. And then further to this idea of central sensitization, you can get an experience whereby previously non-noxious stimuli, and by that I mean not painful stimuli, now become unbearable, and there is an exaggerated response to stimuli. So, for instance, you know, just merely stroking someone's skin in a patient who is not sensitized, that would just feel like having their skin stroked. But for someone who's experienced central sensitization, that can be experienced as an unbearable pain. So that's how I think about the emergence of benzodiazepine-induced neurological dysfunction. I see it as a central sensitization equivalent to that associated with fibromyalgia and or equivalent to that associated with opioid-induced hyperalgesia. So the question then becomes, how do you actually manage this, right? And if you are taking benzodiazepines for a long time, you are going to get cognitive impairment, right? That we discussed in the previous episode. I think it behoves everyone who has been on benzodiazepines for a long term to actually come off benzodiazepines, right? It's going to be hard. It's going to be potentially a protracted journey, but I think it is an important journey to make. Because even in the worst case scenario of this prolonged experience of cognitive impairment after cessation, it didn't last forever. You are going to get better from this. The brain will regulate eventually. So how do we do this? Well, when I was training, I was taught that it's very safe to wean people off benzodiazepines at a rate of about 10% a fortnight. So theoretically, if I'm on 100 milligrams of diazepam, I could wean off 10 milligrams of Valium diazepam every fortnight. So that would be 10 fortnights, which is 20 weeks. So roughly 6 months. And that was what I was trained to do. And that's what I was taught was a reasonable rate to go at. Nothing could be further from the truth. It's come to my attention through various experiences that I've had with patients who've taught me that really, if you're dealing with the situation of having to help someone come off benzodiazepines, especially high doses that they've been taking for a long time, and they're possibly elderly, and they're possibly using various other hypnosedatives, as is usual, you need to do it really, 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 really slowly. And so really, I don't really care how quickly people do it, so long as they are weaning off at their pace very gently, and so long as when you're coming down, you never go up. That's the key thing. You can have weaned down holidays, but you can never go up. So you might spend 6 months weaning from 100 milligrams to 50 milligrams. You might spend a year weaning from 100 milligrams to 50 milligrams of diazepam equivalent. But the second principle is that you need to actually slow down the rate of taper as you are going through the second half of the taper. And certainly in the last 20 to 25 milligrams, I'm very happy to taper at a rate of 1 milligram a month. Because remember, it's not important the rate that you go down. It's simply important that you're actually coming off these drugs, not just for the eventual benefit of relieving yourself of all of the bind symptoms, but also because, let's not forget, benzodiazepines are also toxic from a hypnosedation effect. And if you're on too many benzodiazepines, you run the risk of overdose and death. So actually weaning down off benzodiazepines is really important for that other reason. The third principle is you need to treat the underlying reason or the underlying medical condition for which the benzodiazepine was originally prescribed. So you need to start thinking about what else can I do to treat the underlying anxiety? And, you know, most learned guidelines suggest that selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, otherwise known as the newer antidepressants like Prozac, they're the first-line drugs for anxiety disorders. But the first-line treatment is actually cognitive behavioral therapy. So talking therapies come first, and then SSRIs and various other medications come second. So you need to actually deal with the underlying condition. And then the next principle during a wean is you also need to provide psychosocial support So you need to actually walk with people on their journey because, you know, this is a terrible time for people. Worsening psychomotor agitation, central sensitization, total distress. People need support. People need supportive therapy. They need to be able to share their experiences. And I'm a great believer in peer support groups. And I think we should be starting peer support groups for this condition. The next thing is lifestyle medicine. I'm a great believer in the benefits of lifestyle medicine to help with symptom control. And so, for instance, you know, I think that sleep hygiene is really important because a sleep deficit insomnia is one of the most important symptoms that patients find unbearable almost when they're coming off benzodiazepines. So we really do need to look at what kind of sleep hygiene advice we're offering our patients. And at the end of the day, cognitive behavioral therapy for insomnia has been proven as the most efficacious treatment for insomnia. I recommend lifestyle interventions, including optimizing the diet. So I recommend the Mediterranean diet, or if you're really into diet, then maybe go to the MIND diet. I recommend exercise, at least according to the Australian guidelines, which is 150 minutes of moderate intensity exercise a week. And I define moderate intensity exercise as brisk walking to the point that you can talk, but that you cannot sing. I want to address now the issue of adjunct pharmacotherapy for bind or the withdrawal of benzodiazepines. There was an article published in 2006 by Dennis et al. He was a Frenchman. And they investigated the use of carbamazepine as an adjunct for benzodiazepine withdrawal. It was a paper that didn't have that great evidence, but there was a suggestion, there was an emerging signal that maybe carbamazepine could help with the management of withdrawal from benzodiazepines. Now, I was very excited when I read that paper. However, the authors of that paper actually retracted their own paper, I think, in about 2012, because they felt that the findings were out of date. To my knowledge, there is minimal evidence for the use of carbamazepine in benzodiazepine withdrawal. And that's why I do not recommend it for my patients. Now, also, the National Institute of Clinical Excellence have actually made the following statement. Do not offer sodium valproate or buspirone to aid withdrawal from a benzodiazepine. So we're now getting learned bodies actually come out and state positions against certain medications. So I don't believe there is a specific pharmaceutical intervention that you can offer to help people with benzodiazepine withdrawal. The final point I want to make is that there's been an experience documented in a paper recently whereby patients were not believed by their doctors. They weren't believed when they said to their doctors, I feel absolutely dreadful coming off benzodiazepines, or I feel absolutely dreadful having come off benzodiazepines 12 months ago. So I urge everyone to actually acknowledge the truth of the matter and for any clinician watching, be kind and empathic and empathetic to your patients on benzodiazepines, weaning off benzodiazepines, and also having weaned off benzodiazepines who are still experiencing symptoms. That's all for today, folks. My name is Dr. Ferghal Armstrong, and this has been Cracking Addiction.